Aloha, I'm your Minna Van Dyken MD from Out of the Doldrums. Today, we're gonna talk about two things that are very near and dear to my heart, nitric oxide and the microbiome. We've made a few videos on nitric oxide in the past. I'll make sure to link them in the description below. If you haven't seen them, check them out. They're really informative and they're a good background for what we're gonna discuss in the video today. If you want to take a deep dive into anything we are going to talk about today regarding nitric oxide, be sure to check those videos out. So what prompted this video? Okay, so I got a question from one of you, one of our viewers. His name is Mark. Let's review it. Mark says, I'm looking for some unbiased advice backed by research on the effect of toothpaste fluoride on the beneficial bacteria in the saliva that help with the synthesis of nitric oxide. Are these bacteria completely eradicated by twice daily brushing or only reduced so that if I ate a nitrate rich food or smoothie in between brushings, the bacteria population would still be able to produce nitric oxide in sufficient quantity? Would alternative toothpaste be better? Is timing important to get the best of both worlds? This knowledge could make the difference as to whether the smoothies prove effective or not. Please, what are your thoughts? Thanks for the question, Mark. Very well thought out question, and it prompted a slew of intense research, which we will definitely review. First though, we've got to do a quick review of the science. It matters. So for this quick review, nitric oxide is a very tiny molecule that is super important to our overall bodily function. Let's quickly review what nitric oxide does in our bodies. There are 8 main categories that have been verified by studies done in humans. Not on a petri dish, not in a test tube, not in animals, in humans. So benefit number 1, blood pressure regulation. Nitric oxide has been shown to decrease systolic and diastolic blood pressure in healthy subjects and in patients with hypertension or high blood pressure. Number 2, platelet function. Nitric oxide has been shown to reduce platelet aggregation or clotting. Number 3, blood flow to the brain. Nitric oxide has been shown to increase perfusion in frontal lobe white matter of the brain. Number 4, vascular or blood vessel function. Nitric oxide improves vascular compliance, which results in dilation of blood vessels. Studies have shown increased flow-mediated dilation and have also shown that nitric oxide prevents endothelial dysfunction. Nitric oxide is the molecule that allows blood vessels to dilate, even in the human penis, resulting in successful erections. Number 5, nitric oxide has been shown to reduce oxygen costs during exercise, as well as enhance muscle contractility. Because of this, it's thought to increase athletic performance. Number 6, bone marrow. Nitric oxide has been shown to stimulate and mobilize angiogenic cells, which improve something called angiogenesis, or growth of blood vessels in the bone marrow. Number 7, mitochondrial function. Nitric oxide has been shown to improve efficiency of the mitochondria and reduce proton leak. Number 8, nitric oxide has been shown to be antimicrobial. So, how do we get nitric oxide in our body so we can reap all these amazing benefits? Well, there's 2 main pathways. There's the nitric oxide synthase pathway, and then there's the enterosalivary pathway, also known as the nitric oxide pathway. It's kind of complicated, so let me draw it out for you. So you've got nitric oxide, NO for short. There's 2 main pathways that this is made. The first is the nitric oxide synthase pathway, and nitric oxide synthase is an enzyme that converts L-arginine into nitric oxide using nitric oxide synthase. These details are not really that important to our discussion today, but it's good to know the basics. If you want me to do a deep dive video on this pathway, let me know in the comments below. There's 3 types of nitric oxide synthase: endothelial nitric oxide synthase, neuronal nitric oxide synthase, and inducible nitric oxide synthase. So that's the first pathway. It's kind of boring. The second pathway is much more interesting. So you eat something that has nitrates in it, for example, an arugula salad or a beet. These nitrates get converted to nitrite, but they can only be converted with the help of an enzyme provided by certain special bacteria that live on our tongue. This enzyme is called nitrate reductase. Then, nitrate loses an electron when it is in a low pH or hypoxic environment, a place like the stomach or back of the mouth, and it finally gets converted to nitric oxide. This nitric oxide is easily absorbed into the bloodstream where it can be used immediately, or it's converted to nitrate, which is a more stable molecule and can be converted to nitric oxide at any time. Think of nitrite as the storage pool of nitric oxide. So what's interesting about the second pathway is the bacteria. There are certain bacteria that live deep in the crypts of our tongue. Without these bacteria, no nitric oxide gets created. It's that important. As we age, we lose the ability to make nitric oxide via that first pathway, the nitric oxide synthase pathway. Because of this, it's even more important that we maximize the second pathway, the pathway that involves our oral microbiome. So let's zoom in on the oral microbiome. We know there's several types of oral bacteria that are able to reduce nitrates into nitrite, primarily bacteria from the genera Neisseria, Haemophilus, Granulicatella, Vilionella, Prevotella, Corynebacterium, Actinomyces, and Rothia. We also know that most of this conversion happens at the posterior of the top of the tongue, especially in conditions where there is little to no oxygen. We also see this reaction happening in dental plaque and in certain saliva that is under low to no oxygen conditions. So how important is this enterosalivary nitric oxide pathway? Does it really make a difference in our overall physiology? There are a few experiments that give us a better idea of how important this pathway is. Let's take some time to review them. The first one is a study done in humans that showed that the blood pressure lowering effect of dietary nitrate was completely abolished using an antibacterial mouthwash. So we talked about nitric oxide lowering blood pressure. The study showed that basically antibacterial mouthwash completely shut down this enterosalivary pathway, resulting in no nitric oxide production and an increase in blood pressure. Whoa, that's impressive. Here's another study. It's been well established that consuming beetroot juice can lower blood pressure because of its high nitrate content. This study showed that consumption of beetroot juice lowered systolic blood pressure, and they then showed that spitting saliva as opposed to swallowing saliva also blocked the reduction in systolic blood pressure. I found this fascinating. So the moral of the story, make sure you swallow your saliva, don't spit it out. So back to the mouthwash question. There was a really good study done by Vikas Kapil et al. Done in 2013 titled, Physiologic Role for Nitrate Reducing Oral Bacteria in Blood Pressure Control. In this study, researchers showed that twice daily use of an antiseptic mouthwash for 1 week nearly abolished oral conversion of nitrate to nitrite. More importantly, this was accompanied by a decrease in plasma nitrite concentration, 25% or so, and an increase in blood pressure. I think we can safely conclude that antiseptic mouthwash is bad for our enterosalivary circuit and nitric oxide production. It's estimated that close to 60% of the US population regularly uses antibacterial mouthwash. So let's get off that Listerine habit. What if you're a person who loves that clean mouth feel after mouthwash? Well, you could try some of the more natural mouthwashes that contain essential oils and less toxic ingredients, but there's really no research on this. We do know that even essential oils can negatively impact your oral microbiome, but not to the same extent that antibacterial mouthwash does. Stay tuned for an upcoming video of an oral microbiome improving nitrate producing mouthwash that you can make at home. One that's actually good for your overall health. Okay, so back to the topic at hand, oral hygiene. A common question I get is what about tongue brushing or scraping? Does that impact nitric oxide production? I researched this and what I found is super interesting. This study gives us a pretty good answer. Researchers did find that tongue cleaning does have a significant impact on tongue bacterial community composition, and daily cleaning, either once or twice, results in an increased proportion of H. para influenza and other proteobacteria, which are major nitrate and nitrite reducing species of the oral cavity. So basically, tongue cleaning, including scraping and brushing, appears to be beneficial for our bacteria that are involved in nitric oxide production. What we're finding is that tongue cleaning seems to keep those harmful bacteria at bay, and this allows the beneficial microbes to flourish. Also, did you know that one of the leading causes of halitosis or bad breath is failing to regularly clean the tongue? Okay, so now we know antiseptic mouthwash is bad and tongue cleaning is good. What about Mark's original question? What about toothpaste, especially antibacterial toothpaste? Does it decrease nitric oxide production? I searched quite thoroughly, and unfortunately, there really isn't much research on this. Let's summarize what we know. Here is a randomized, controlled crossover trial done in 16 women, demonstrating that the use of antibacterial toothpaste does not inhibit nitrate reduction or blunt increases in circulating nitric oxide. This is encouraging, but in the study, they did not clarify whether the participants were brushing just the teeth or the tongue as well. Remember, the majority of our nitrate-reducing bacteria live in the crypts of the tongue. Even though we established that brushing the tongue seems to be beneficial, what about brushing the tongue with a harsh toothpaste like triclosan toothpaste or fluoride toothpaste? That hasn't been studied. So unfortunately, Mark, I don't really have a black or white answer for you. In situations like this personally, I usually err on the side of caution. So options would be using a non-fluoride toothpaste or using a more natural toothpaste. I don't have any affiliation with either of these brands, but I really like David's Natural Toothpaste and Risewell Toothpaste. And I routinely brush my tongue. And I use my nitrate-loaded oral microbiome approved mouth rinse. And my husband likes to brush with baking soda, to each their own. Okay, it's a wrap. I hope you found this video informative and applicable. If you like this video, please give it a thumbs up. If you want to show us some real support, subscribe. We love hearing from you, so leave us a comment down below. Let us know what you thought of the video. Let us know what your oral hygiene routine looks like or how you're planning to improve it. Until next time, everyone, stay safe, stay healthy, and aloha.